We're going to adjust the schedule and start with our blessing for obvious reasons. So I'd like to begin by having us center ourselves for a moment on the scripture that's on the screen, Hebrews 13. It is in that spirit that we have gathered. And I am delighted to have as a colleague and friend, as a member of our clergy host committee in Chicago, the Reverend Gerald January, Sr. of Vernon Park Church of God. We have asked him to do an affirmation and a blessing of the meal, and he will come now in his own way.
Knowing that I'm the only thing between you and this chicken, let me hurry on. She said, you have a 4-minute affirmation and a 30-second blessing. My affirmation is simply titled, When Victims Really Forgive Their Offenders. In April of 1959, in Detroit, Michigan, on the west side, 5 blocks from Northern High School, I was 2.5 years old, and I witnessed a man put 4 bullets in my mother's head. For 10 years, I was told that she died in a car accident. They didn't think that a young child that young would remember something like that, but I remembered. I'm here to say to you that young folks always remember. Today, there's another reality like there was one for me, and at the age of 13 years old, through a cousin, I discovered in my last 3.5 minutes, I discovered that my mother was murdered, and I knew I wasn't crazy. There are a lot of people on the south side of Chicago that they say are crazy that they're not. I found out also that not only was she murdered, I found out she was murdered by my hero. For the man that I honored more than anybody in the world was the man that murdered my mother. Did not realize that that big shadow I saw with the .38 caliber gun in his hand that ran out the side door of our apartment in my last 2 minutes was my father. When I was told he was in the Army, I found out actually he had been in Jackson State Prison for 3.5 years for her murder and then released. So from the time I was 13 years old, from the time I was almost 18, my freshman year in college, I swore to myself someday I'm going to tell him how I really feel, because in those days you didn't tell off your daddy. I remember driving home on Christmas break in my last 90 seconds, driving home in my father's car. He came to get me after football season to come home, which was a surprise to me. And he turned to me and he said something that changed my life. He said, Gerald, I'm sorry. My father's never in my entire life said he was sorry about anything. And though he was the coolest man I ever knew, he put out a cigarette for a moment. And for the only time in my life I saw a tear in his eye, he said, I'm sorry what I did to your mom. I didn't even know he knew that I knew that he had murdered her. And I had made up in my mind, Doc, that the day that he knew that I knew, I was going to cuss him out. But it taught me that day. I'd been a Christian 11 months, and it taught me that day what mercy was, because the only word that came out of my mouth was, Daddy, it's okay. And he said, really? I said, yes, sir, it is. 40 years later, after my mom's murder, he died in Detroit. And when his funeral was going to be held at Swanson Funeral Home, I flew from Colorado to the funeral. And they had hired a funeral home preacher to do the eulogy, because they figured I wouldn't do it because there should be all this hate. And I dismissed him from the pulpit and said, now that's my daddy. No one can tell his story like I can. When the church really forgives the offenders, because sometimes crime happens close to home, and there's also a component in our church at Vernon Park, when you follow great leaders like Claudette Wyatt, like I did, his heart being Joshua to Moses. And our job has been now to broaden the stage. We just bought 75 acres of land to do a community that's self-help of our own. I thought I wanted my father to hurt in my last 10 seconds, but as he got older and I realized he never forgave himself, the last thing I wanted my daddy to do was to hurt. There are a lot of criminals that have to come out of the prisons, but if we really are the church, we'll be able to say, it's all right, you've paid your dues, now come on home. Let's pray. God of heaven, thank you for this fellowship. Thank you for this food. Bless our time together in Jesus' name. Amen.
We've gathered under this theme of reckoning with power, destroying caste, and restoring community. And in many different ways, by song, by preached word, by workshop sessions and plenaries, all have led us to one road, and that is the road to the power of the Spirit for us to overcome these challenges. We have said this in many different ways. We have said that these times require, as Susan would say, a new world, a new way forward. A new way forward built on an old way of understanding that we must occupy what we have claimed to be the intelligence of the heart, and that we must be empowered by the Holy Spirit to stand and to speak truth to power on this journey to be free at last. This luncheon has been convened with a special, special purpose in mind. It is another opportunity for us to engage one another as we commune and to hear from three of the most prolific, profound thinkers and activists in this human rights movement. It is a movement which is grappling with mass incarceration. But as our doctor in the house told us this morning, it is really a movement about understanding the serial displacement that we have got to confront. Because we may destroy this movement, but another one is coming if we don't change and transform the world and the way we see ourselves in the world and the values that we have as we relate to one another. We are truly indebted to the support of the Drug Policy Alliance, which has supported and sponsored this lunch. I hope that you have each gotten a brochure which gives a bit about their vision and the work that they do. And we also take great pride in having a new partnership with the Justice Policy Institute. And as you were coming in, you should have gotten a little drive that has much knowledge and information on that drive that will allow you to begin to have the kind of data that will drive the way in which you can strategically do the advocacy and activism in your respective communities. I want to take a moment to ask all of the Board of Trustees of the Samuel Dewitt Proctor Conference to stand. The only reason I'm standing is because I get to stand on their shoulders and their legacy and with their support and vision and intelligence. Let us celebrate them. We all thank you for your vision, your faithfulness, and certainly their courage. Among our special guests in the House, we have at least 40 members of the United Methodist Church who have come to our conference as a delegation. And I would just ask them to stand as well. This is the delegation and this denomination that is leading the way to divestment of the shareholding stock in the privately held prisons. And so they have led the way. And after this conference closes officially, we're going to have a small meeting of representatives from various denominations. And so we want to replicate the work and the model that you have set for this entire country, and we thank you for that. Now, we don't do this work just by ourselves. We find ways to have conversations and convince others that we are worthy of their investment. And so the Proctor Conference is very blessed this year to have received support of our efforts from one of the most progressive, strategic, I would think endowed foundations in the world. The Open Society Foundations. Our program officer, Sean Dove, is somewhere in Europe, I believe, this week, and so he could not join us. He is the director of the Campaign for Black Achievement with a vision to interrupt, to intersect to do whatever is necessary to dismantle the pipeline from cradle to prison. So we have, though, his right and left hand, his spirit, and the feminine side of the intelligence and wisdom that we've already proclaimed. And that's Maisha Patterson Gatson. And Maisha, please, as you come, I want to share that every time we are together, she has a certain lens and a certain process of taking in information where she's always connecting the dots. And I'm sure by the time she leaves here today, she will have new ways for us to identify other possibilities for support for us to collectively do this work. Maisha, we thank you for all the support you have given us, and we'd like you to bring us remarks.
Good afternoon. First, giving honor to God, from whom all blessings flow. To the leadership and the staff of the Samuel Dewitt Proctor Conference, Dr. Iva has been such a blessing. I can't say that she's one of my favorites, but unofficially. It's been such a pleasure to work with her and the Samuel Dewitt Proctor Conference. You know, foundations don't fund revolutions, but by the grace of God, we have managed to get a revolution funded. I'd be remiss if I didn't mention the vehicle that God sent to create this window of opportunity, Mr. George Soros. Through his personal commitment and dedication to this issue, Mr. George Soros was not only courageous enough to fund this effort initially in 2008, but he also put his money where his mission is and scaled this campaign up in 2011 by allocating $89 million over the next 5 years to improve the lives of black men and boys in this country. So under that banner, in the last three and a half years since the inception of the campaign in 2008, we have had the opportunity to invest nearly $30 million into 94 organizations across the country who are working to improve the lives of black men and boys. Our campaign goals really speak to the need to advance a counter-narrative around black men and boys in three areas. The first, attaining educational equity. Really making sure that the barriers to success are broken down so that our black boys have the opportunity to excel academically, prepare for and graduate from college, and learn skills that enable them to earn a living wage. The second, strengthening families. Talking about fatherhood, responsible fatherhood initiatives. If we listen to the narrative that was out there about black fathers, we would believe that black fathers are absent. They're not active in their children's lives. But the research actually tells us that black fathers are more active than other races in their kids' lives. But there are barriers, policy barriers, that we're working on to remove in the child support system that will help to enable black fathers to be more active in their kids' lives. So we're working to strengthen families. We also are supporting some efforts to support single mothers raising black boys. So we understand it's about strengthening the families. Third, expanding work opportunities, advocating for living wage work through policy advocacy and labor best practices. So we were really glad to hear about the position that you guys took to support the labor unions here in Chicago. And God certainly blessed that. We're really proud of that. So finally, we work to strengthen the field of black men and boys through investments in strategic communications, really changing perceptions and images of black men and boys in society, philanthropic leadership, trying to bring our colleagues and other foundations to this issue and to fund more organizations doing this work. Capacity building, we have a really exciting opportunity that we're working with Root Cause in Boston called the Leadership Sustainability Institute. We believe, you know, there have been these windows of opportunities that have opened over time and time again. You know, some foundation gets an idea to put some money into this issue, and then they stop funding it, and our organizations perish. There was an Urban Institute report in 1995 that found, after one of these peaks and valleys, that of the organizations that had received funding, once the funding stream left, 25% of those organizations no longer existed 5 years later. And of the ones that existed, 50% of them no longer did work in the Black male achievement field. So there's a great need to build the capacity of our organizations so that the field is not just dependent on the ebb and flow of foundational dollars, and we're committed to building that. And lastly, leadership development. We've taken a city-based approach, so we fund in primarily in six cities, Chicago, Milwaukee, New Orleans, Jackson, Baltimore, and Philadelphia. And we're really proud of the work that has been done here in Chicago. I'd like to take a point of personal privilege and to really acknowledge my grandfather, the Reverend Dr. Artie Moore from Stockton, California, who showed me early on through his life and his leadership that ministry is bigger than just the pulpit. And I feel so... And I feel so profoundly blessed to do this work because I consider it my ministry, and so does the whole team at the Campaign for Black Male Achievement. We take this personally. We take it home with us. It lives with us. Every funding decision that we make is personal, and we make a personal investment in our partners. We don't consider them to be solely grantees. We feel that we're blessed to be a blessing. The communities we're dealing with are wrestling with spiritual issues that have sociological ramifications. But sociology can't fix these issues. We feel that projects void of any spiritual context generally are only surface. This work is generational, which is why we're really honored to support the work of the Samuel Dewitt Proctor Conference, and so very pleased to be partnering with them on this important work to dismantle the new Jim Crow. So I want to take the opportunity to acknowledge a few of our other grantee partners that we've been able to support here in the Chicago area that are in attendance at this conference, and many of them have presented during the workshop sessions. Philip Jackson, the founder and executive director of the Black Star Project. He has galvanized a movement around fatherhood, utilizing his Million Father March in not only Chicago, but in the nation, and even internationally. Dr. Wilson Good and Harold Dean Trullier with the Philadelphia Leadership Foundation, they're a new grantee, but I love the work that they're doing using the Healing Communities model to work with churches in Philadelphia and Baltimore to organize around issues of reentry and to train congregations in the Amachi model to infuse mentoring into congregations. Omalara Williams McAllister and the Question Bridge team. They took the simple concept of one man asking another Black man a question and transformed it into a transmedia community engagement movement. I'm sure a lot of you guys have had the opportunity to see the installation that's on display here. Saquon Lawrence with the Chicago Jobs Council. It's working to break the barriers facing fathers in the child support system through linking that with job development and policy advocacy here in Chicago. Robert Biko Baker, his work is actually in Milwaukee, but he was here presenting yesterday with the League of Young Voters Education Fund, is using arts and culture as a tool for leadership development and mobilizing young people. Third World Press, under the leadership of Haki Marubuti, is one of the nation's oldest and well-respected independent publishers of Black thought and leadership. Other Chicago partners that are, I don't believe, in this room, the Kenwood Oakland Community Organization, the Black Youth Project at the University of Chicago, the Metropolitan Area Group for Igniting Civilization, the Dovetail Project, and I mentioned Third World Press. In conclusion, we know the problems that are facing our Black men and boys, and they are devastating. Now we're working on the solutions, and it couldn't come at a better time. And we couldn't do that without the leadership of the Samuel Dewitt Proctor Conference. So we look forward to partnering with you over the next few years. Thank you.
With God, all things are possible. In all of my years, I've never had an opportunity to pray with program officers over the work that we do. And so this is really a unique investment and journey that we have shared and come together with full recognition and affirmation that we serve an awesome God. I'd like you to share with me now a video that our team has put together that will help to kind of frame the conversation that we're going to have shortly.
Today, the Samuel Dewitt Proctor Conference is building a bold new movement to dismantle our nation's latest system of racial and social control, mass incarceration. This movement, Occupy the Heart to be Free at Last, is a broad-based commitment to basic human rights, compassion, and justice for all. We are not on this journey alone. This short video highlights just a few of our partners.
MARCHA program is a program designed to intervene in the lives of children of incarcerated parents. We seek to find a loving, caring adult for every child who has a parent in prison or who has been in prison. What we know is that on any given day, there are 10.7 million children with one or both parents in prison. And what we know is that 70% of those children, unless something is done to intervene in their lives, will end up in prison themselves. We believe that this program will, in the years to come, have a significant impact on the reduction of black men, especially going to prison.
Today, the urgent need is to reverse the deadly trends destroying the lives of so many of our young people. We believe we all have a responsibility to answer our children's cry for help.
I'm in.
I'm in.
I'm in.
I'm in.
I'm in.
Are you?
The Sustainability Institute has a green jobs program that goes into the communities to reach those that may have a barrier, those that might be out of work during this current state. And what we do is we recruit them and we put them through training so they can learn cutting-edge technology on how to be energy efficient. Not only what they can do for their own homes, but what they can do for a community, what they can do for an occupation and a career. So far, we've been very successful. We have watched lives transform. We've made differences in numerous of households. And most of all, we have really created a momentum of individuals that are getting the light and walking into pathways of success.
And I saw an opportunity to learn a new trade. So I chose to take courses that led me to Energy Conservation Corps that set me up to get a permanent job. It's a long time coming, really. I've been in jail, couldn't find no job when I got out of jail. And the program, they accept felons. So there's literally no excuse why you can't succeed, because the tools are here, the classes are here, the company is here. There are people here to help you, and ECC is one of them.
A truly disturbing new report from the Justice Policy Institute exposes just how depraved some privately owned prisons have become. They're apparently using campaign contributions, lobbying, and political relationships to actually increase prison populations. The report says, quote, "Over the years, these political strategies have allowed private prison companies to promote policies that lead to higher rates of incarceration and thus greater profit margins for their company."
When you hear people all over the world saying, we shall overcome, whether it's China, South Africa, and the old Soviet Union, or East Germany and Poland, that inspiration came from really 14 churches and a small group of people in a southern city that most people had never heard of. I know most people had never heard of Martin Luther King before the March on Washington, and Birmingham was before the March on Washington. And the world has changed so drastically in these last 40 years. I'm not the smartest fella in the world, not the richest fella in the world. Nothing about me or Martin Luther King was particularly exceptional. It's my belief that there is a divine spirit, a Holy Spirit, that's moving in and amongst the affairs of men and of nations. And we think of that as the coming of a kingdom. And I think when you look at PICO organizers, that's essentially what they're doing. They're mobilizing deeds of love and mercy to make our communities and our nation more like the kingdom of God.
This is Louisiana State Penitentiary at Angola.
The average sentence here is about 93 years.
More than 85% of Angola's inmates will die in prison.
They know I need the bobs. They keep setting it back. I need help.
I know you do.
I'm watching dudes die here daily. Ain't nobody going home. They got life sentences. This is death.
Something in you gonna open up, or you not human.
Hospice referred to as a process of helping one die with dignity. But more than that, I feel it's helping one live our life with love.
Can they find redemption serving life?
I am a human rights activist. And when you are a human rights activist, and when you look at the phenomena of the war on drugs in the United States, you cannot escape the fact that this is not just a human rights issue, but an issue of racial justice as well. Now, I want you to look at the numbers on this thing. The United States, our nation today, we have less than 5% of the world's population. We have almost 25% of the world's incarcerated population. We rank first in the world in the per capita incarceration of our fellow citizens. The Russians, the Belarusians keep huffing and puffing to keep up. They can't do it. We are number one in the world, number one when it comes to locking up our fellow citizens. When it comes to locking up people for drug charges, we went from having 50,000 people locked up on drug charges in 1980 to over 500,000 people today, never mind the hundreds of thousands of more on parole and probation violations related to drug charges. Right? You look at that, we lock up in America more people for violating a drug law than all of Western Europe locks up for everything. And they got 100,000,000 more people than we do. Right? Now, I want to ask you something. Do any of you think that would be possible if the vast majority of people behind bars were white? Any of you think that were possible? Because I know and I can see that there is something that happens in this country that when you see a television program, when you see a movie, a photograph, and when you see the pictures of the prison populations, and when you see they are overwhelmingly black men, brown men, that there is that little thing that clicks. That little thing clicks. That's okay. That's right. Because I know that if the vast majority of those people were white, we would not be leading the world in incarceration rates. I know that the movement for reform would be moving a lot faster than it is right now. And I'll tell you, when it comes to the war on drugs right now, when I look at that in the history of America, I can look from slavery to Jim Crow to the war on drugs. No better system has ever been created to accumulate massive, vast millions of people, black people primarily, and put them behind bars, give them a number, take them away from their homes, put them in upstate communities, dissolve their identity, treat them as second and third and fourth class citizens the rest of their lives. That is what the war on drugs is doing today.
She really doesn't need an introduction.
Has been immunized.
Her book
from judicial scrutiny
has
for
hit
bias much as
the top bestseller list. And I keep hearing over and over again, wherever I go, that there are meetings all over this country, regardless of what profession you're in which people are talking about the book, The New Jim Crow, Mass Incarceration in the Age of Colorblindness. She was with us last year, and when she was with us, she lit the house on fire. She inspired us to go back and do all that we can do, and we have gathered with stronger power and clearer vision ever than before because she was with us last year. We know that she envisioned and led the Driving While Black campaign while at the ACLU, and as an attorney, she came very clearly to see the link between the war on drugs and mass incarceration. She was convicted, but more importantly, she was called. And she was called to come to the faith community to bring the message. We have a short bio on Michelle in the book. You can read that. But what is most important, Michelle, is, as I said when we opened the plenary on Monday, is that you come with a sweet, serene disposition. You come humble in spirit, but you also come authoritative and persuasive. And it is your authoritative and persuasive voice which we cherish. And just know that we love and will continue to surround you with our prayers and protection. And she has brought with us two of her long-term colleagues, and they will join us today in a conversation. I'm going to let Michelle introduce them, but please help me welcome Ethan Nadlemann, who is founder and director of the Drug Policy Alliance, considered the czar on this issue in the world. Please come to the stage, Michelle and Ethan. Along with Neil, along with Major Neil Franklin, who is Executive Director of the Law Enforcement Against Prohibition, known as LEAP. Neil is a 34-year law enforcement veteran who has dedicated his life to addressing the consequences of the war on drugs. Thank you, and welcome.
Well, I just am so thrilled to be here with all of you. I've just been looking forward to this conference for some time and delighted to have the opportunity to engage in meaningful dialogue with two of my personal heroes. You know, we had talked about what the format should be for this afternoon, and originally we planned to kind of give speeches and pontificate from the stage, which we love to do. But then, you know, we gave it some further thought and decided maybe it would be more useful for us to have a deep conversation, not just about the facts and the data, but about our journey. Our journey in this effort to end mass incarceration, end the war on drugs, and turn with more care, compassion, and concern towards all those who have been locked up and locked out. I had the opportunity just recently to visit Howard University, and they invited me to speak not so much about my book per se, but about the relationship between my faith in my career, my ethics, and my life's work, my values, and the movement building that I am so committed to. And it was such an extraordinary opportunity. So often I'm invited to share a lot of facts and data and describe the history of mass incarceration, which I'm always eager to do, but it's not so often that people actually want to talk about the relationship between one's faith and one's values to the work that we're doing and so committed to here. And so we're going to have a bit of a conversation about our personal journeys in this work and how we have each, in our own ways, come a long way, transformed our own thinking over time. When I was here last year, I gave a speech in which I described my journey from someone who cared deeply about racial justice and was working as a civil rights lawyer and advocate, but who somehow managed to be utterly blind to the existence of a caste-like system right before my eyes. And I described how there was a young man who was I was considering representing in an individual case who told me his story of how drugs had been planted on him by the police and now he had a felony and couldn't find work and housing and had to sleep in his grandmother's basement and couldn't even qualify for food stamps because of his drug felony, and how I told him I couldn't represent him because of his felony record, that we weren't representing people who had criminal records because we feared the media would be all over us saying, well, of course law enforcement should be keeping your eye on folks like them. They have felonies. And we felt we couldn't put someone on the stand who had a criminal record without them being cross-examined about their prior criminal history. And so I had refused to represent that young man and later learned that he was actually innocent. He had been telling me the truth. The police had planted drugs on him, and I had turned away. And that process of finding out a lot about myself, how many of the racial stereotypes that I condemn others for, turns out I held some of them myself. And I began to see how I, as a civil rights lawyer, was actually replicating so many of the forms of discrimination and exclusion I was fighting against, not allowing people with criminal records to tell their voices and to be heard, and how I myself was part of the problem, not so much the solution. And so that really began my own journey, and asking myself a lot of questions, doing a tremendous amount of research, and listening more carefully to the stories of those cycling in and out of prison. And as I shared at Howard, I became obsessed with the desire to help others have the same kind of awakening that I finally did. I became obsessed with wanting to share the information. I wanted to dispel the myths about the rise of mass incarceration. I wanted people to understand that no, crime and crime rates did not give birth to mass incarceration. Crime and crime rates have not driven the sudden unprecedented explosion in black incarceration. I wanted to dispel the myth that people of color were more likely to use and sell drugs than whites and show to them the research, the data proving that's not true. It's just not true. I wanted to dispel the myths about violence in our communities and help people to understand that the get tough tactics of rounding up people in mass and saddling them with criminal records was actually contributing to the very problems we were supposedly trying to solve. But as I traveled around after the book was published and engaged in dialogues with lots of different audiences, I came to realize that the most important myth that I needed to dispel had nothing to do with all of this facts and data and the histories of these various systems of racial control. The most important myth that I had to dispel was the myth that some of us are not worthy of genuine care, compassion, and concern. That was the core myth that sustained this entire system. And that once we effectively challenge that core myth, this whole system begins to crumble, to fall like dominoes. And that was another awakening for me, that actually I was on a spiritual mission, not just a truth-telling, fact-telling mission. But I found myself challenged by a couple of the people here on the stage, because as I began to talk about the need for us to show genuine care, compassion, and concern to each and every one of us, I was asked by Neil Franklin, what does it mean to show genuine care, compassion, and concern to someone suffering from drug addiction or drug abuse? What does it mean? Do you put them in a cage, Do we turn drug addiction, drug abuse into a crime? Or perhaps we should legalize all drugs? And I found myself taking a deep breath and saying, legalize all drugs? Wow, is that what care and compassion requires? I found myself in conversations with Ethan Nadlemann about needle exchange programs, and him effectively saying to me, that's what care and compassion requires. And I found that it is so easy to say we should have care, compassion, and concern for each and every one of us, but then when faced with real life policy choices, we can recoil and flinch and say, oh, well, isn't there another way to show care and concern? When we hear the story that was shared with us earlier, that care, compassion, concern, forgiveness means forgiving your father for murdering your mother, you think, can I do that? So this is about kind of the journey of all of us, of looking in the mirror and saying to ourselves, what am I capable of? How far am I willing to go in showing genuine care, compassion, and concern? And what policy changes must we embrace as a nation if we are going to genuinely show that concern on a larger scale? I want to begin with Neil Franklin, who is the executive director of LEAP, Law Enforcement Against Prohibition. Law Enforcement Against Prohibition, like its name, is an extraordinary group of law enforcement folks, only law enforcement folks, current as well as retired. I believe most of your membership is retired. Prosecutors, police officers, judges, who now believe that drug prohibition is as disastrous and harmful and misguided as alcohol prohibition once was. And
right.
Yes. And as I've shared with Neil, it's been difficult for me to get to that place. It's easy for me to say that I support decriminalization of marijuana, given that the harm associated with a marijuana cigarette pales in comparison to the harm associated with being saddled with a criminal record for the rest of your life. But legalization of all drugs has been a difficult, difficult position for me. But I found that by keeping my mind open and learning more, I find myself inching closer and closer to embracing a position that would focus entirely on a public health model as opposed to a criminal justice model. And so I hope that you'll share with us a little bit of your journey, because you began as a drug police officer, a narcotics officer, right, and after a few decades came to the view that the entire project of the war on drugs and drug prohibition was horribly flawed, and that it was impossible to win the war and to do justice as long as we continue to criminalize drugs and drug use.
Well, let me first begin with, if I can make this transformation, anyone can. Because I've had a double portion of maybe even a triple portion, beginning with growing up in Baltimore and receiving the social portion of prohibition. You know, drugs are bad. They cause so much harm within our communities. And Baltimore, known for its heroin addiction problem, and seeing that growing up, so there's the impression, you know, there's the social Kool-Aid about prohibition for me. And then I go into law enforcement too. Now I'm taught.
So how old were you when you joined the force, and what was your first job? I know you early on was a narcotics officer, but yeah. Walk us through it.
Yeah, I joined when I was 18 years old in the Maryland State Police Cadet Program. And I followed my brother into law enforcement, and it wasn't too long after I became a certified trooper in the late 70s that I went into undercover narcotics work. Because once again, I'm under the impression that we're doing a good thing, that we can keep drugs out of our communities, and I think we all know that we can. And so I'm really charged here, you know, so prohibition is the way to go, and that's what I'm saying. I received a double portion, but then here I'm also a Christian, So I've got this moral thing going on in my head too. So that's why I'm saying really a triple portion of why we should remain with prohibition. At least I thought so. I thought so. And I moved through the ranks, you know, so I was first arresting hundreds of people for mostly nonviolent drug offenses. I'm not talking about violent dealers. And then I'm commanding drug task forces responsible for thousands of people being arrested. And I don't have a clue as to what's going on in our communities dealing with incarceration and the problems that that causes. Don't have a clue. All I know is that we have to keep pressing forward and pressing forward and pressing forward, completely lost. And unfortunately for me to begin to turn, it took a travesty. It took the assassination. Of a close friend. It's been 11 years. And it's still tough. Because every time I think about him, I think about his family. And that got me to pause for a moment. You see, because before you can open up your mind and look at this, you have to open up your heart. And in doing so, I begin to recognize and pay attention to all the other people who were dying. See, it wasn't just cops. If any of you are from Baltimore, I know you remember the Dawson family on Preston Street, a family of seven who were murdered by one drug dealer because the mom was working with the police, as good citizens should do, to get him off of that corner in front of their home. He sets their home on fire one night and kills the entire family. This isn't just Baltimore, folks. Here in Chicago, Miami, you know, New York, Los Angeles, any major city, we've got the same problems. And I haven't even begun to talk about Mexico, and I'm not going to because that's another 30 minutes. And then you. When I, you know, went through that tragedy and I went on the website looking for other cops who were beginning to think like I was starting to, I stumbled across the organization LEAP and their new website, and that's how I became a member and started speaking for them, and now I'm the director. But 2 years ago, I saw an interview of Michelle by a reporter, and this is when your book was just coming out. And I said, wow. And then I got the book and I contacted Michelle and I said, when I finish reading your book, I'm gonna get back in touch with you. And I did. What brought me here was violence and the ripping apart of our neighborhoods because of violence of the drug trade. It's about the policy. You mentioned marijuana. The more dangerous potentially a drug is, the more need for regulation and control to remove it from a criminal marketplace. Do you understand what I'm saying? Because I came to this through violence, but when I read your book, I saw the other half of the story, mass incarceration. And you know, it was mentioned earlier, the truth will set you free, as it says in that great book. In the King James Version, it says the truth will make you free, but whether set or make, you're really not free until you move on it. Until you move on it. Then you're free. I'm free. And I'm going to continue to move on it. And I want to let you guys move on. So.
No, thank you for that.
That's my journey.
I know that in some of our conversations, you've talked to me explicitly about kind of the relationship between your faith and your commitment to legalizing all drugs, and that for so many people, you know, in communities of all faiths, but I think especially for many Christians, there is a sense that there's a conflict between supporting drug legalization and their own kind of moral commitments or their faith commitments. Can you say a little bit about that?
Yeah, real quick. I guess as you can see, I'm not lukewarm on this issue. You see, because you really have to pay attention to how God orders your steps. And it was mentioned earlier that the ministries are not always in the pulpit, even though my brother's trying to get me there. But in due time, this is my ministry. To change how law enforcement has become either a witting or unwitting part of this issue and this problem. I thought that it was going to occur when I was the head of training for the Baltimore Police Department and the Maryland State Police. But see, I was looking at it on a very small level, and God doesn't look at things on a small level. So paying attention to where he's been taking me, that's why I'm looking at this now on a global level, because our organization is a global, international organization, because it's just not unique to the United States, where we have these issues of drug prohibition and violence and people being in prison. It is a global issue.
Okay, well, I'm going to get to Ethan in a second, but one last question for you before I bring Ethan in, which is, you know, one of the conversations we've had has been around why it's not enough, in your view, to end the war on drugs. I often, in my speaking and in my book itself, I call for an end to the drug war, saying we can cut off all of the federal funding for these drug task forces that have resulted in sweeping, you know, particularly young people into the system for nonviolent drug-related offenses. We can end these harsh mandatory minimum sentences for drug offenses, you know, repeal drug forfeiture laws that give, you know, law enforcement a monetary incentive to round up as many folks as possible, that we can do all of this, right, end the drug war without legalizing drugs. Can you share with folks, I know that it's a, you give a 40-minute version of this answer, yeah, sometimes, but as succinctly as you can, why in your view that's not enough and that legalization of all drugs is something we need to seriously entertain?
Well, you know, this is what I see. And as I mentioned, I grew up in Baltimore. I policed in Baltimore like any other major city. And we've got so many wonderful programs that are picking boys and girls, you know, out of this, you know, who have been in prison and who are dealing with these issues, and they've dropped out of school. And we're having one little success after another through these wonderful programs. But if we want to have monumental success, I think a significant piece of this is ending the illicit drug trade in our streets, because I've seen not only are our young boys and now young women attracted to this lifestyle and being part of the game, but they're recruited into this. And my mother, my sister, my aunt, you know, they're teachers, and you know, they say, you know, before you can teach a child, you need their attention. You need their attention. And with the social challenges that we have in our communities on an economic level, you know, jobs, and I realize that money has to be made. See, I'm looking at this as the beginning to solving our neighborhood issues of solid family units. Because before you can have a solid neighborhood, you need solid families. Before you can have a solid community and city, you need solid families and neighborhoods. It goes back to the family. As in your book, when you look back in the 19th, this issue has ripped our families apart with sending all of these young and older black men into prison. We need to rebuild that.
And your view is that the only way to end the illicit drug trade is to eliminate the market, the illegal market, and so government should in some fashion regulate that market but make it impossible for people to make a profit on the street.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You have to do that. We've been here once before with alcohol prohibition. It only took us 13 years back then to realize it didn't work. But look who the victims were back then. They didn't look like us, did they? The victims today, the folks in prison today, look like us. That's why it's been 4 decades, folks. The only way to do that is to end the illegal market, take the money out of it, and then, but we have to make sure that the money saved is reinvested in our communities that have been devastated by this.
Yeah. And let's like to bring Ethan Nadlemann into the conversation, who's the executor of the Drug Policy Alliance. And Iva was not exaggerating when She said that, you know, he is really the leading expert on drug policy in the world. So we're very grateful that you took time to be with us here today. And I'd like to hear a little bit about kind of where you agree or disagree with Neil, but maybe you could start by sharing a little bit about your own journey, how it is that you came to this work and became so passionate about it.
Yeah, well, thank you, Michelle. And it's a tremendous honor to be here and to have this opportunity to be on the stage with two people I admire so much and in front of all of you. God, my own journey on this stuff. You know, I guess part of it starts with growing up in a very sort of religious family. I grew up the eldest child of a rabbi. And growing up in a fairly, you know, moral background. And then I went off to college and I smoked some marijuana. I liked it. And I mean, I liked alcohol too, but people were getting busted for marijuana, and alcohol was so obviously much more of a dangerous thing. And it just kind of registered with me, and it did not keep me and most of my friends from doing relatively well in school and such. Some had problems with marijuana or got into other drugs, but most did not. And I just kind of registered that. And then I think the second thing, Michelle, happened was that I think as I stayed in academia, I liked school, I was good in it, there was a part of me that began to realize, or maybe more subconsciously than consciously, that I needed my intellectual pursuits to somehow be linked to something I felt emotional and even political about. And there was this thing which still kind of, you know, because I was still getting high occasionally, I was thinking, you know, there is this thing, and then this is already the 1980s, and the drug war was just beginning to heat up in those days. It had kind of quieted down during the Jimmy Carter days. And I just started thinking, well, maybe I'm going to start to look at this and work on this and research this stuff. And I did. I got myself research grants. I got a security clearance. I worked in the State Department's Narcotics Bureau. I wrote a classified report. I interviewed drug enforcement agents all around the world, American Farm. I got to know these guys and spend time with them. I basically went undercover on the undercover guys. And I saw that they, like anybody else, covered the spectrum from really great guys you'd want to hang out with to people you really want. I mean, almost like in any profession at all. And I ended up writing a dissertation book, becoming a professor. But what was so obvious was that there was something fundamentally wrong with the way we were dealing with drugs in our society. And the more I read and the more I studied, the more I realized this wasn't just about marijuana. This was a bigger thing. And it wasn't just about America. It was about the broader society, about the broader global society. And that the more you read of the history and the evidence and the science and the economics, the more you realized how a thoughtful, intelligent, enlightened approach took you here, whereas the politics of this nation and the culture was taking you here. And that disparity struck me as this incredible emotional sort of intellectual puzzle. Now, there was something else to this. I think the thing that gave me the passion that I've had for this, if I ask deep down what was it about, apart from the fact that I could sort of connect to it as somebody who was an occasional marijuana user, I think the other part really was my consciousness of Jewish history. And not just my father being a rabbi, but my father having been born in Berlin, having to flee in 1939 with some of his family to Ecuador and then to the United States after the war, and knowing that my father's father, who I never met, who had fought for Germany in the First World War, won the Iron Cross, and then in the late 1930s had been picked up by the French police, given to the Nazis, and enslaved and murdered in Auschwitz, and that my people had been hunted down and persecuted like vermin in one of the most venal racist oppressions in world history. And what I understood was that any time a majority thinks that it needs to impose its particular morality on the minority, and not just for our sake, but for their sake, That's trouble. And I became aware of the fact of the extent to which majorities of societies could be swept up into passions filled with hatred and fear, justified by apparently upstanding moral principles, and somehow justify the massive disparagement and almost elimination of particular members of their society, transforming them from their neighbors and human beings into something less than neighbors and less than human beings. Now, So what happened in the late 1980s was that I started to speak and write about this, and the first person who became my partner in this and who remains one of my heroes was the former chief prosecutor of Baltimore who got elected mayor, Kurt Schmoke. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And Kurt Schmoke, you know, as a mayor in the late 1980s and 1990s, he stands up one day at the National Conference of Mayors, and he's giving a little speech on the drug thing. And he throws away his assigned text, and he finishes off by saying, more or less what Neil was saying, I have prosecuted these crimes. I have seen this. I have fought against drugs. I hate drugs. I know how devastating drugs can be to my community. And the story that moved him, as it did with Neil, was listening to an audio tape of an undercover agent who was murdered by some drug traffickers. And he got to hear it on the audio tape of the fellow being murdered. And his thought, he goes, after the initial anger of wanting to kill the drug dealers, was, to what end did this man get murdered? To what extent is his life going to result in any fewer drugs being available on the streets of Baltimore tomorrow, or a week, or a month, or a year from now? What was it about? And he had the guts to step out. And I'll say then, you know, it was probably maybe a year later that, you know, in my own kind of spiritual way, it just kind of struck me that this issue is my calling in life, that teaching and preaching and speaking and learning about the way we deal with drugs in our society is what I need to do, and that ultimately this is not just about drugs, that this is about broader principles, that this is about how we treat our fellow human beings, that this is about how we deal with our fears of the other. This is about how we take every parent's passion, every parent's desire to wrap our baby in a bubble, and every parent's fear that somehow drugs or those needles will pierce that bubble, and therefore we have to pay any price and bear any burden to keep that thing at bay, and to understand that we have to allow our hearts and our rational minds to work, and that we need to take certain risks to move into a new way of dealing with this. And so let me just finish this part by saying my own, you know, I do this everywhere. I mean, you know, I was in Dallas and Denver 2 weeks ago, and I'll be in Mexico and Guatemala next week. And I'm building alliances from law enforcement to labor unions to business to African Americans to Latinos to parents to, you know, people abroad to you name it. But there's been this particular personal struggle or anguish in engaging this issue around African Americans. Because stepping back, and as I said in that video you saw, I didn't come to this as an issue of racial justice. I come to this as a human rights activist. But when you do come to this as a human rights activist, and you see who this war on drugs is grossly disproportionately affecting and not protecting, right? Then you just start to wonder, so where is everybody on this one? Why am I getting pointed out about, like, oh yeah, you're just some white guy who likes to get high, and you can say that for you, but where's it? And I remember sitting on a major TV show with Ted Copeland, Nightline, back in the late 80s, sitting between Jesse Jackson and Charlie Rangel, and the two of them going back and forth joking about Mayor Kurt Schmoke, and hell, that's a one-term mayor if they ever saw one. Well, he did get elected twice.
Sure did.
And he was right. And they were wrong. And you know what? The last I saw, Jesse Jackson and Charlie Rangel, two of the leaders, in my view, of the drug war 25 years ago, have now endorsed what Kurt Schmoke was saying 20, 25 years ago. So I see that transformation. I remember when needle exchange was intolerable because both black and white churches would say, how could you possibly give junkies the needle that will enable them to kill themselves? And then I saw when the black leadership in the Congressional Caucus forced that issue in the Congress and forced that thing to change. I've seen that transformation. I've seen the way African-American legislators have taken the lead in state legislatures and in Congress now. I've seen the way the older black leadership is seeing the younger black leadership beginning to open up and move and talk reality about this stuff. And I've also seen people I respect. I've seen Ron Daniels from the Institute of the Black World embrace this issue and step up and say the sorts of things that Neil is saying right here. I've seen my dear friend and board member Ed Sanders, right? You know, minister in Nashville, who had the guts to open a needle exchange program in the basement of his church in the 1990s. The guts and the morality and the principle to understand that ultimately this was about stopping the spread of a deadly disease for which we have no cure, and that life is preeminent. So I think the momentum is shifting, and I know this is not easy because I know how devastating drugs are and can be. And I know that I and many others have the luxury of being able to dabble with these things and enjoy them, but so many other people do not have that luxury. And they and their families have to struggle as a result. But that doesn't mean that the war on drugs and the policy of massive incarceration that has been embraced in this society to an extent that no democratic society in history has ever done so, it does not mean that it should or can persist.
Yes. Well, I want to ask Neil one more question, and then we can open it up and have a broader dialogue if some of you all have questions as well. But, you know, I think the issue that Ethan raised is a very important one, kind of where has the black leadership been as this drug war has decimated African-American communities, has so clearly been targeted, particularly at African-American men. What accounts for the long silence, the long pause? I know that in my own work, as I've traveled around doing radio shows, speaking to audiences, that it is not at all uncommon for me to face some of the kind of most severe criticism from black ministers who say something to the effect of, well, if these young men would just pull up their pants and do right by their children and get off the drugs, then we wouldn't even have this problem. We wouldn't be having this conversation. And so even within, you know, many of the communities that are most affected, you see faith leaders, people of faith, kind of backing away from, you know, critiquing the drug war itself, drug prohibition itself, and placing most of the blame for mass incarceration on the shoulders of young black men in particular. What do you think accounts for that in your experience?
Well, the first thing I want to say is, in case you haven't, folks, in the first page here, where you have great Dr. Proctor, there's something written here. It speaks very much about compassion. So I think everyone needs to read that. I think that's the first place to begin. The second thing is, you know, I'm not going to hold anyone accountable for something they may not know. For it, forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do, but in this case, know not what they know. But once you have the information, once you've read her book, once you see the statistics behind this, once you are well informed, if you continue to support the status quo, then I have an issue with you. The information is being made available to you, not just the folks here, but to other leaders on Capitol Hill. We're doing whatever we can to meet with our legislative leaders and our leaders in the faith community. And now it's time to hold people accountable because they know what the problems are and how to resolve them. Now, I want people to understand one thing about the term legalization. I'm talking about strict regulation and control. I'm not talking about drugs being handed out on Halloween, okay? I'm talking about a strict method of regulation and control, because under the current policy of prohibition, you have a one-man drugstore on every corner who will sell to anybody that's got the money. This is the worst possible scenario we can have for drugs infiltrating our communities. We've got to take it back, and we've got to figure out some form of regulation and control. So I'm ready now to start holding people accountable, and I will.
All right, and Ethan, just a final word. To what extent do you support drug legalization across the board, or are you not there yet?
Well, I'll tell you, my organization, the Drug Policy Alliance, we represent that spectrum of opinion that goes from the group like Neil or like leading conservatives or libertarians who would say, let's legalize everything for adults, to those folks who are basically more or less where you are, Michelle, right? It's who are ambivalent about the issue of legalization but want to decriminalize drug possession, treat addiction as a health issue, to do there. My hope, I live for the day when we can move American and global policy down the spectrum from the drug war to here, when we can move the public debate here so that those who are arguing with Neil are, and those who are arguing, say, where you're coming from about more and ambivalent about how far to go, can have where that's the mainstream debate. Personally, I would boil it down to three things. The first one is with marijuana. I mean, you know.
No brainer.
You get it. You know, marijuana does not need to be in the criminal justice system. And when half of the 1.6 million people arrested on drug charges last year was arrested for having more or less a joint, and when the racial disproportionality you see in other parts of the drug war on marijuana, I mean, the studies are conclusive. If you pick up randomly 100 black kids, 100 brown kids, and 100 white kids, and you look in their pocket, roughly the same percentage of each is going to have pot in their pocket, maybe a little less among the black kids, right? So when they are being arrested at 3, 5, 7, and 10 times the rate of the white kids in almost every major city in America, you know, come on. And quite frankly, is there a risk of legalizing marijuana? Yes, there is. Is there a risk that more people will use it? Yes, there is, right? Now, will some people substitute marijuana for alcohol or pharmaceuticals that are oftentimes more dangerous? Yes, they may, right? Is there going to be an explosion of marijuana use? I don't think so. And you know who's going to be the least at risk? It's young people. Why? Who has the best access to marijuana and other drugs in America today? Teenagers. Right, 80% consistently say they can get marijuana like that. Who had the best access 10 years ago? Teenagers. 20 years ago? Teenagers. 30, 40, teenagers. Who's going to have the best access no matter what we do 10 and 20 years from now? Teenagers. Three surveys, teenagers say it's easier to buy marijuana than it is to buy alcohol. Okay, so I'm a little more worried about all the people in their 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, and 90s because some of them don't have such good access to marijuana. And once they realize it helps a little with the arthritis, and, you know, but I'm not that worried about grandma and grandpa getting high occasionally. So I think marijuana, so there's going to be ballot initiatives, and they're in Colorado, Washington State are going to get to vote on legalizing marijuana this year. It's an uphill battle. Already 50% of Americans are there. You know, the federal government's going to try to stop it. Once we win one of these state battles, the feds are going to try to make it a mess. So it's not going to be easy getting there, but we got to get there. Secondly, with respect to any drug, if you possess a small amount of that drug for your own use or you use it, you don't deserve to be considered a criminal. I mean, I embrace a principle, which I don't know if all of you embrace, but the core principle in the struggle for me and my organization is this. It's that nobody but nobody deserves to be punished simply for what we put in our body if we don't hurt anybody else. That's my principle. Get behind the wheel of a car and you're high, go to the workplace and you're high, hurt someone and you're high. Don't tell me that we should excuse you because you're an addict. People need to be held responsible for the harms they do to others, whether they're under the influence or not, and let the judge use his wisdom about how that should be dealt with, right? But by and large, if you simply possess this stuff for your own use and that's it, that should not be a crime. And thirdly, that for those people who are absolutely committed to trying to are going to get this stuff, whether it's legal or illegal, whether it's because they're addicted or not, if they're going to, they don't care whether it's legal or illegal. They're going to get it one way or another, from the street, from a pharmacy, a super, wherever they're going to get it, they're going to get it. What I would say is offer them drug treatment, offer them a helping hand, try to dissuade them, try to get them out of their drug use and their drug addiction. But if they are determined, allow there to be a place, a clinic, a government-licensed place where they can go and get what it is they want. What they have done in Europe now, in over a half dozen countries, is to say, if you've been addicted to heroin for years, if you tried to quit through methadone, it didn't work, and drug-free, it didn't work, and jail didn't work, and nothing worked, and basically heroin is your lady love, and you cannot imagine living without it, well, then you come to this clinic, and you can get it. And you can get as much as you want. You can't take it home, but you can get as much as you want. Take it right there. And you know something? Every place they've done this, what they found is, it reduced the AIDS, it reduced the overdose, it reduced the arrest, it reduced the crime, and the people in the program started using less drugs. And you know what else they found? That for people who'd been illegal heroin users for many, many years, and now all of a sudden they could just show up a clinic and there it was, for free, or maybe $5 or $10 a day, depending upon where it was, you know what happened? They began to realize that their addiction wasn't even about the heroin. It was about the life. It was the thing that got them out of bed in the morning. It was the thing that got them going. And then all of a sudden what you had is people for finally offering what they thought was their godsend, heroin for free, what I live for, strive for. And you know what they said? They looked in the mirror for the first time, not because a judge was holding a stick over them and telling them to do it, but because they had the opportunity to look at it. And they said, I've had enough. That's the essence of the philosophy called harm reduction. It's the understanding that when you take people who have been drawn into the drugs and the dealing and they're getting into it and it's all about, you know, what you're going to tell the man and the opportunity on and all this sort of stuff, and you get somebody who is the man, tell him to stop that, that'll work for some people. But when you allow people, when you don't stigmatize them or make judgments upon them based upon what they're putting in their body, when you simply accept them as your fellow human being, that's when people have a chance to step back and take a breath and ask what their life is about. That, you know why needle exchange programs are sometimes the number one point of referral into drug treatment programs that are drug free? Is because needle exchange programs give people a chance to step back and be treated like a human being, notwithstanding the fact they're putting a needle in their arm. And when they're able to step back and be seen and treated as a human being, then their eyes open up. The weird place where harm reduction intersects with the 12 steps movement is they're both about recognizing that if you want to put an addiction behind you or you want to avoid it happening in the first place, it is about uncovering, rediscovering, discovering your own fundamental dignity. The war on drugs does not allow for people's dignity. That's why it's not working, and that's why it doesn't deserve your support.
We have a special presentation to make, and we would like to, I'm looking for Lee, assume she's on her way, ask Dr. Jeremiah A. Wright Jr. to come to the stage, please. When I was in New Orleans several months ago, I met this young lady from Boston, Lee Farrell, who I later found out is the founder and the trustee of Do Right Ministries. She has been working with those behind bars for many years, and she has supported the art that is created behind bars. And some of the art that has come to her is a part of our exhibit in the art gallery. But she shared with me something that she wanted to present at this time to Dr. Wright, and I'll let it speak for itself. So Dr. Wright, are you on the stage? Yes. Lee?
Good afternoon. Thank you so much, Dr. Iva. I really appreciate your friendship and your solidarity in this mass incarceration work. I would first like to say that on behalf of 13 men and State Correction Institution at Dallas, Pennsylvania, I make this award, or this presentation rather. It is through their vision and their work that I've been inspired to really become part of connecting healing and forgiveness and the voiceless men and women in state correction institutions back into society to really give back in a way that they can raise their collective voices and we actually see the humanity in all of them. So it's in this vein that I would like to make this presentation to first Dr. Iva, because it is a surprise for her. She thought she was surprising Dr. Wright, but I'm surprising her. So Dr. Iva, on behalf of Do Right Ministries, 13 men, this piece of art was created as a result of reading a book that I sent to these men several years ago called Up, Down, Under, Black Theology in Post-Slavery. And this picture depicts their vision, having read that book, which talks about shouting the pot. And in our history as black people, as descendants of Africa, we once had to turn the wash pot upside down in the slave quarters in order to worship and praise away from our slave masters. And this picture depicts that rendition that they collectively came up with. And the author of this piece is Brian Ross, and we give it to you in love. Thank you. Dr. Wright, on behalf of Do Right Ministries and my loving Aunt Lee Farrell, one of the men is my nephew. I had another nephew who was killed very violently as a result of trying to find out about his first cousin who had gotten into trouble. But nonetheless, it is the men of Do Right Ministries' honor to present to you Jeremiah's Lamentations. Jeremiah's Lamentations as a true representative of our godly duty to stand for righteousness and stand against injustices. The men of Do Right Ministries see Dr. Jeremiah Wright as a true representative of hope for equality and change from the status quo of black folk biting their tongues. It is with our words and your courage to speak truth to power that inspired this painting and companion poetry. And here is the poetry. As with the biblical prophet Jeremiah, lamenting against the disobedience against God's children, the chosen nation, your lamentations against the injustices of a nation that pretends to be the contemporary shining star, shining city on a hill, speaks volumes of the need for this nation to repent before God and man. For its evil ways shrouded in concepts of respect for human rights, equality, and the spreading of democracy and this nation's so-called values to and fro, up and down the face of this earth. In a serene manner, Jeremiah's Lamentations depicts the atrocities committed against black folk during the era that spawned the civil rights movement, church bombings, the murdering of our little angels in Birmingham, attacks of dogs and fire hoses, and white hatred, all sanctioned by governmental policies and segregation. One of the first projects I had to do when I first began to learn to paint, I painted a wall mural. My mentor and I chose to paint a rendition of a painting by a black artist that depicted a late 1800s to early 1900s scene inside a black church. And they go on to say, because this is a personal note to Dr. Wright, so I'm going to read the final conclusion to this note. But essentially, the white guards made fun of the mural on the wall that they were painting. And as a result of them making fun, one of the black guards came by and said, I know what you guys are doing. I know exactly what you're doing. That man standing in this painting is Dr. Jeremiah Wright. Why are you doing this in front of his white counterpart? So that goes on to say that in this piece that I'm reading. But to expedite time, I just want to say in closing, now come in full circle from within the bowels of the belly of the beast known as mass incarceration to the socially and culturally profound modern day prophet known as Reverend Jeremiah Wright, and to all of you saviors who have joined the force of good combating the evils of mass incarceration and powers and principalities which support it, Do Right Ministries presents to you this painting and companion poetry entitled Jeremiah's Lamentations as 2 million plus tokens of appreciation from encaged men, women, and children within the land of the free for the righteous fight you have undertaken, knowing that good will ultimately prevail over evil, even while we are living upon this earth. May God bless you and the entire Samuel DeWitt Proctor Conference with a strengthening patience to endure the travails of that of what will be a protracted war. May God bless and, more importantly, be merciful to America. On behalf of Gabriel Pittman, Gregory Steffens, Carl Sheldon Daniels, Sean Sharp, Brian Ross, William Philip Africa, Michael Mileto, Joaquez, David Lee, John Baldwin, Caesar X. Grant, and Maurice White, who is in the audience with us today, who was incarcerated with these men at the time that Jeremiah's Lamentations was painted. He was there to physically see this. Maurice is a little shy to come up to present to Dr. Wright. So we thank you so much for your attention. And we love you, Dr. Wright, for your courageous and your spirit-filled fight for justice.
Well, let's give God the praise for all that we have seen and heard already. I just want to give, I'm called on to give some brief comments. But first, let me introduce myself. My name is Reverend John E. Jackson. I'm pastoring in Gary, Indiana. But Brother Neil, my ministry actually started when I was a police officer in Chicago, specifically assigned to the projects in Chicago, from Henry Horner to Rockwell Gardens to Cabrini Green to Robert Taylor, Ida B. Wells to Altgale Gardens, Trumbull Park. And being a police officer during the Clinton administration, we participated in these large sweeps where hundreds of people were just locked up for things as low as not having your ID to having a little drugs on you or just being on the premises and not being a resident, and that was because the policy said to the housing authorities that you must lock up so many people a month. And so having participated in that, I thank God that I have a chance now to try to help undo some of that I was an unwilling participant in. But also in hearing this powerful panel that we heard, I guess the first thing I would say is we are called to feel something, and preferably without experiencing some tragedy that will force us to feel it, but that we might just begin to feel for people's lives, because again, we're talking about human rights, we're talking about people, we're not talking about cattle. And so for those of us in the Judeo-Christian and Islamic heritage, we know that Yahweh in Exodus told Moses that Yahweh saw the oppression of the people. Yahweh heard their cries, and Yahweh came down because Yahweh felt something to do something about it. And then in the New Testament, the Gospel of John records that for God so loved the world, God, because God felt something, came and did something about it, because everybody is precious. There are no, there's nobody that is beneath another. Everybody is cherished. And the second thing and final thing is, perhaps once we feel something, it will drive us to begin to question some policies, whether it is legalization or whatever form that may be, so that we can get this oppressive system off of people's back. But also, those of us who are Christian, I heard underneath that, because so many of us are so quick to put people in hell, and perhaps it causes us to wrestle now with this concept of hell and who's going there, because we seem to know who's going to hell all the time. And it's not a far jump. If you can put people in hell and you're not the hell gatekeeper, then it's not a far jump that you can just look at people in prison and say they belong to be there. So with those two points, I think and I pray that we leave out of here wrestling with some things because we feel for people. And in the closing words of a friend of mine, Mama Brenda, who is an activist, who is a preacher, who is a poet and a spoken word artist, who works on the west side of Chicago, in one of her powerful pieces, she said, and this is the continued refrain, somebody better say something. Somebody better feel something. Somebody better do something before it's too late. Let's answer her by saying we are those somebody who will say something, who will feel something, and who will do something. Amen.